Praise the Lord, dear brothers and sisters. It's so beautifully blessed time to be here with each one of you. And we've been going through these moments of difficulty, uncertainty. And yet through it all, the Lord is showing us that He is in control. Amen?
Amen.
Yes, many of us have been trying to get in touch with each other over the last couple of weeks. And probably we have not been able to. But the Lord has blessed us with this opportunity. And we thank God for the core team, for the technical team who has put this facility together, that we can come and experience praise and worship as we used to do at the MIPC. So even as we start this time of praising and worshiping God, on behalf of Carmen and myself, I would like to invite each one of you as we together as one body of Christ praise, worship and glorify our living God. So let us all together sign ourselves by the sign of the Holy Cross. O Lord, deliver me from all that is evil. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And as one family, let us hold hands as we pray to our Father that He truly bless this time, and to our Mom Mary that she intercedes for us and is here with us, along with the host of angels and saints, to praise and to worship together the Heavenly King. As we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
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 Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, dear brothers and sisters. And I would just like to read the scripture. It's from Romans 8:35 onwards. And it says, can anything cut us off from the love of Christ? Can hardship or distress or persecution of lack of food, clothing or threats or violence? As scripture says, for your sake we are being massacred all day long and treated as sheep to be slaughtered. No. We come through all of these things triumphantly, victorious by the power of Him who loved us.
Amen.
For I am certain of this, it's neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nothing already in existence and nothing still to come, nor any power, nor any heights, nor any depths, nor any created thing whatsoever will be able to come between us and the love of God known to us through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. This is such a powerful text of scripture. It says that nothing and absolutely nothing can come between us and the love of God. And even the situation that we are in right now, it's nothing but an opportunity for us to draw closer to the Lord, to get deeper into His love, for He cares for us. And we will sing this song. It's called Who is Like the Lord. The words of the song go, there is no one like Him. He is mighty. He is powerful. So let us all stand up and praise Him and glorify our living God. Amen.
Amen.
Are you ready to praise the Lord?
Yes.
Amen. Like the Lord.
Who is like the Lord? There is no one who is like the Lord. He is strong and mighty. Who is like the Lord? He is worthy. Stand up and give Him the praise. Praise the Lord. Rising up. praise Him and give Him the glory. Stand up and praise Him and give Him the glory. Stand up and praise Him and give Him the glory. Stand up and praise Him and give Him the glory. Our God is worthy of praise.
New for us every day, O Lord God, and your faithfulness is for generations, O Lord God.
Amen.
Father God, we just want to praise you in this time as we sing, O Lord God, as we glorify your name, O Lord God. Every praise, O Lord God, be unto you, Lord God. Every word of worship in one accord be unto you, Lord God. Every praise be unto you and you alone, O Lord God.
Yes, Lord, because you alone are deserving of it.
Every praise is to our God.
Praise you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord God.
Hallelujah. We bless you, Lord.
Father God, we just want to thank you for the moments like these, Lord God.
Yes, Lord.
In these moments, Lord God, we have come to understand the depth of your love for us, Lord God. In these moments, Lord God, we have come to understand how much you love us, Lord God. That even though this world at the moment is going through a turmoil, you have held us in the hollow of your hands, Lord God. We want to thank you, Lord God, that in spite of all that is happening around, you have held us close to yourself, Lord God. As your word says in Psalm 91, Lord God, that 1,000 may fall dead beside you, 10,000 all around you, but you will not be harmed. And Father God, we just want to thank you and praise you for your love, which surpasses all understanding for us, O Lord God. We want to thank you, Lord God, for the gift of family that we are be able to be with our family, our loved ones, O Lord God. And Father, we pray especially, Lord God, for all those who aren't with their families right now, Lord God, that you be their source of joy and their strength, O Lord God, and you take care of their family members wherever they may be, O Lord God. Father God, we want to sing this song unto you, O Lord God. Your steadfast love, O Lord God, it extends to the heavens, and your faithfulness, O Lord God, reaches to the clouds. Your righteousness is like majestic mountains, and the wisdom that you give, Lord God, through the power of your Holy Spirit is like the depth of the sea, which cannot be fathomed at all. Amen. And so as we sing, Lord God, minister to us in this time, Lord God, and let your presence be here with us, O Lord.
Filling my heart with your love. strings of rejoicing. You are my King.
Yes, Lord.
You are my King. You are my King.
Hallelujah. You are truly our King, O Lord God. You are our Maker, Lord God. You are our Deliverer, Lord God. You are the one who prepares for us a banquet in the presence of our enemies, O Lord God. Hallelujah, Lord God. We thank you. We praise you. We bless your holy name, O Lord God, because you are the same yesterday, today, and forever, Lord God. And your love is for generations to come, O Lord God. Thank you, Lord. We praise you, Lord God. Hallelujah, Lord God. Praise you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord.
Yes, Lord. Truly, we are thankful, Lord. We are thankful for your steadfast love, Lord, which surrounds your people at all times, Lord. Thank you, Lord God, that even in this time, Lord, all that we need to do, Lord God, is keep our gaze upon you, Lord. And if we do that, Lord, we know that we will walk upon the waters, O Lord God. Even if right now the waters, the seas are raging, O Lord God, we ask you, Lord, for that grace to keep our eyes upon your beautiful face, O Lord God. Yes, Lord. We want to say, Lord, that we are sorry, Lord, if we have shifted our gaze, O Lord God. If, Lord God, our gaze has been upon the situation that we are in, Lord God. If we have made this mountain, Lord God, bigger than you, Lord God. Yes, Father. By keeping our gaze upon this COVID situation, Lord God, it has become a huge, big mountain, Lord. Every day, Lord God, we want to know the numbers, the fresh cases, the numbers that have passed away, Lord God. And all that is only causing us to be filled with fear, Lord God. But Lord, if our eyes are upon you, Lord, we know that we will be filled with faith and filled with life, Lord. Yes, Lord. You have said, do not fear, I have overcome the world. You are the God who has overcome death. And we are your people, Lord. We ask forgiveness, Lord God, for making this bigger than you, Lord God. We ask forgiveness, O Lord God, if we have also slowed down during this slowdown, Lord. If spiritually, Lord God, we have slowed down during this lockdown, we ask forgiveness, Lord. If we have got too caught up in the mundane, everyday things, Lord, and not spent time in you and in your word, Lord God, we ask forgiveness, Lord God. If at all, Lord God, with the family rather than bonding in love, if we have been stepping on each other's toes, Lord God, getting angry, getting irritated, getting frustrated, forgive us, O Lord God. If we have slowly been slipping into habitual sins, O Lord God, wash and cleanse us, Jesus, with your precious blood, Lord. O Holy Spirit, come with the fire of your love and burn out the dross from our lives, that we will be able to once again fan the flame of love in our hearts for the Father and for the Son. A love which will keep us strong in you at all times, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, dear brothers and sisters, in this time that we prepare for the feast of the Pentecost, these beautiful days of grace, let us right now come in repentance, acknowledge the places where we have gone wrong, and once more tell the Lord that, Lord, Once more we want to gaze upon your face. Once more we want to give you that central place in our life, O Lord God. And know that nothing else matters and nothing else is of more significance than you are, Lord God. As we sing, Blood of Jesus, wash away my sin, to the tune of Living Waters, let us truly come to the Lord with a repentant heart. Blood of Jesus, flow on. Wash away my sin. Bring your healing to my heart. Help me love once again. Fears and worries get me down. Fears and worries get me down. Fear of failure fills my day. When I'm lost and all alone, help me, Lord, to find your way. Living waters flow on.
Want to experience
your divine presence, your divine touch in this intimate moment with you, Lord God. True intimacy, oh my Lord, is what we seek, is what we desire, is what we are longing for, oh Lord God. Yes, Jesus, we come to adore. Lord, we want to tell you, Lord God, that we want to honor you, Lord. that let it be the desire of our heart, O Lord God, to always stay close to you, to always walk with you, Lord, no matter what the situation may be, Lord God, to always keep our hand in your hand, O Lord God. Brothers and sisters, as we sing this song, this is my desire to honor you. Let us once again recommit our desire, our love, and our decision for the Lord.
Good evening, dear brothers and sisters. May the peace, joy, and love of Jesus Christ be with each and every one of you and your families wherever you are at this moment. Let us close our eyes for a moment and pray. Loving Father, we thank you for this time. Thank you for each one of us. Thank you for your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. Lord, we thank you for the technology and making it possible for have this virtual prayer meeting, praise and worship, and sharing of the Word of God. And I pray at this moment, Lord, the meditation of my heart and the confession of my mouth may bring glory and honor to your name, O God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. This evening, as we begin, I just want to give you a short synopsis on the life in the Holy Spirit that I shared in the month of October last year during Life in the Spirit seminar. Let's quickly go to our Bibles. Those who have the Bibles, please open Bible to Gospel of John chapter 14, verse 26 and 27. Gospel of John chapter 14, verse 26 to 27. And let's read together. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Let's read it once again. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Holy Spirit is also known as Paraclete, derived from the Greek word Parakletos, P-A-R-A-K-L-E-T-O-S, which means there's a multiple description which attributes this word Parakletos, Paraclete, means advocate, helper, intercessor, mediator, guide, strength, revealer of all the things to come, the one who leads us all the truth, glorifies Christ, reminder, proves the world wrong about sin. That is the definition of Paracletos, the Holy Spirit. So we know who the Holy Spirit is. In the salvation history, we see the presence and power of the Holy Spirit in three important events, among many other. There are a lot of events that are recorded in the scriptures, but I've taken just three. The first one is the beginning of creation, Genesis chapter 1, verse 2. We see the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit there. And the second place, we see the presence of the power, presence and the power of the Holy Spirit is during the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ, Luke 1:35. Luke chapter 1 verse 35. And the third place, third event that we see is the birth of the Catholic Church, the day of Pentecost, Acts chapter 2 verse 1-4. So what are the three important events, specific times where we see the presence and power of the Holy Spirit? Yes, beginning of creation, birth of Jesus, you're right, and birth of the Catholic Church. And some of the ways to experience the life in the Holy Spirit in our own personal lives, these are some of the ways that I've recorded. One is by seeking the Holy Spirit. Seeking means seeking the kingdom of God. And we know what the kingdom of God is. We sing that beautiful hymn, righteousness, peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. And that's the kingdom of God. That's the kingdom of God, righteousness, peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. And that's the kingdom of God, which we read in Matthew 6:33. And we read, seek ye first my kingdom and righteousness, and all other things will be added unto you. First seek my kingdom and righteousness, and all other things will be added unto you. And secondly, asking. First one is seeking. Yes, you're right, seeking. The second one is asking. Luke 11:13. Let's go to Luke 11:13. Luke 11:13 says, if you then who are evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask Him? How much more the Heavenly Father will give the Holy Spirit to those who ask Him? So ask for the Holy Spirit every day of your life. And the third one is thirsting. Third one is thirsting. And let's go to Revelation chapter 21 verse 6, the last book of the Bible and last but one chapter. Chapter 21 verse 6 says, then he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I give water as a gift from the spring of the living water of life. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life, which refers to the Holy Spirit. And the fourth one, His sacraments, especially the sacrament of reconciliation, coming back to God, and the sacrament of Eucharist, the Eucharistic celebration, and sacrament of reconciliation, the beautiful thing that happens is, and as David cried out in Psalm 51, he said, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me." And finally he says, "Restore unto me to the joy of thy salvation." So each time we are reconciled to God, we are restored unto the joy of salvation. That's the beautiful sacrament we Catholics have. And the another way where we see the power and presence of God in our lives is through prayer meetings and family prayer. Yes, prayer meetings once a week, and our cell meetings, our ministry meeting once a week. Yes, it is important. But here I emphasize the importance of family prayer. Praying in the morning for a little time, praying in the evening before you go to bed a little time, all together. There is tremendous unity in that family prayer, which often we underestimate. We don't realize the importance. In Matthew chapter 18, verse 19 to 20, we read, "If two of us agree and ask, it will be done for us by my Father in heaven." This is what Jesus says. If two of you agree on earth and ask of it, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, there am I in their midst. There am I in their midst. That means the presence of God is there in our midst. In our midst, in our family prayer, He is there in our midst. And whatever we ask in agreement, He will bless us. That is why we say, your intercessions, you don't need, actually need an intercessor ministry to pray for your needs. As a family, pray together with your family. Hold hands. There's a tremendous power, tremendous bonding, tremendous unity, and in agreement, God will do it for you. Whatever you ask, and in line with His commandments, in line with His will, plan, and purpose for your life. And we understand that Holy Spirit is both power and person of God. Holy Spirit is both power and person of God. Why do we pray for fresh outpouring of the Holy Spirit daily when we already received Him, or only during this Pentecost time, or during Life in the Spirit seminars? Is He restricted only to that particular time and event? No. 1 Corinthians 3:16 we read, saying that, "Know you not that you are the temple of the Holy Spirit, and the Spirit of God dwells in you?" Don't you know that you are the temple of the Holy Spirit, and the Spirit of God dwells in you? What a blessed man am I? What a blessed person am I? Can you believe? Can you comprehend that God of majesty, splendor, and glory coming to dwell in a body like mine, making my body His temple, and is dwelling within me, and I'm not aware of that power, that presence, that anointing of Him? Can you imagine this? And also we read in 1 John chapter 4 verse 4, the first letter of John chapter 4 verse 4, we read, "The one who is within me is stronger, powerful than the one who is in the world." And we know who is in the world. And we also know, as per 1 Corinthians 3:16, who is in me? The presence and power of the Holy Spirit is in me. The mind, the spiritual mind, is in me. In me, in each one of you, dear brothers and sisters, He is dwelling within us. And often we are not aware of His presence and power in our lives. Why this happens? Why we are ignorant? Because of our sinful life. Because of our lust, our worldly desires, and attachment to the worldly things. And there are two powers at work often in our life. One is the Holy Spirit power and the evil spirit power. Like Paul said, I get into doing things that I don't want to do, and I do the things that I'm not supposed to do, and I don't do the things that I'm supposed to do. What a wretched man am I? But he says, thanks be to God that through Jesus Christ I have been made worthy. So let us believe that Jesus Christ has made each one of us worthy to experience the presence and power of the Holy Spirit in each one of us. Another thing, another aspect is why we don't experience the power is we quench the Holy Spirit. We listen to His voice, we listen to Him speaking to us, but we often turn a deaf ear to Him. We don't want to listen, but we want to listen to the other power and keep doing what the world prompts me to do. Holy Spirit stays dormant in my life for above reasons, and we need to activate His anointing in my life. I can give you a few examples, and one is, you know, whenever you are sick, when you go to the doctor, and the doctor will give you a bottle of syrup, cough syrup or any kind of syrup, and he says, and it's written there, shake before you use. And why they are saying shake before you use? Because the composition of ingredients need to mix well, so that when you take that medicine, when it mixed well, it gives you the desired effect into your body and brings about health and cure to the sickness that you are having. Secondly, you see the mobile that we have with us. If there is no Wi-Fi, if there is no data on your mobile, you cannot use most of the functions there. You cannot Google, you cannot get into websites, because there is no Wi-Fi, there is no data in that. You have a beautiful mobile, smartphone, very, very smart, smarter than you, smarter than me. The phone is very, very smart, but there is no data and it's of no use. It will be dormant. It will lie dormant in your home or on your desk. And thirdly, like a balloon and a cycle, bicycle tube tire. What happens? You blow that balloon, you tie it and, you know, hang it somewhere and pump your cycle and make it good, full of air, and then leave it somewhere. You don't use it for 3 months and you see what happens. Both becomes flat because you don't use it. You don't use the functions. And that is what happens to us. We have the Holy Spirit within us, but we don't activate Him. And then when we don't activate him, He lies dormant in us. Then I spoke about the gifts and fruit of the Holy Spirit. We know the gifts which we read in Isaiah chapter 11 and in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and we read about the fruit of the Holy Spirit in Galatians chapter 5 verse 22 and 23. Galatians 5 verse 22 and 23. Holy Spirit is a continuation of Jesus, and Jesus clearly said, unless I go away from you, the Holy Spirit cannot come and reside in your midst and in you. So Holy Spirit came into the world in order to continue and complete the mission that Jesus has started in us and in the world. So we are called to continue the work and mission of Jesus on this earth. That is specified in Matthew chapter 28 verse 19 to 20. And we have a very good assurance there that Jesus will be with us till the end of age. Are we good people? Sorry? Yes. Yeah. We are all good people. Yes, we are. But according to worldly sense, we are good people because we do a lot of good things. We work well, we do our work good, good work at home and at our office, and we do a lot of church work and so on and so forth. So people know us as good as in the worldly sense. But what is the scriptural definition of a good man? As mentioned in Acts chapter 11 verse 24, where the scripture speaks about Stephen, it says, for he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and faith. This is a scriptural definition of a good man. So you know to analyze yourself. And now let's come to the work of the Holy Spirit. Work of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, what the Holy Spirit does in my life? He teaches me to pray. Romans 8, 26, 27. When we don't know how to pray, the Holy Spirit prays and sighs and groans that I don't understand. He prays according to the will of the Father. Will of the Father. And also Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18. Chapter 6, verse 18. We read, pray in the Spirit at all times, in every prayer and supplication. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18. We read, pray in the Spirit at all times, in every prayer and supplication. Now pray in the Spirit. When we don't know how to pray, pray in the Spirit. All those who have the gift of the Holy Spirit, if you don't have, ask for this gift. Ask for this gift during this Pentecost Novena time. I remember I had a very important project to be done some time back. And I knew that there was very, very little time to get certain approvals and get this moving. And on the day we were supposed to execute this, in the morning I realized that we are running short of certain permissions and approvals from government authorities. And I was nervous because I knew the consequences and penalties. If the project doesn't take off on that day, I'll have to pay $30,000 a day as penalty. And that happened to be a weekend, and in the morning at around 9 o'clock we came to know, and we have time till 2, the government office work up to 2, and we had to get the permission. I didn't know what to do, and I asked my colleagues to go to the respective authorities and get the permission, but we couldn't. Then we had to go to the higher authorities, and that was around 12 o'clock, and we have just 2 hours left now. And then when my colleague went to the higher authorities, I came home. I knelt before the Lord, knelt before the altar, cried to the Lord, and I prayed in the Spirit. I prayed in the Spirit. I said, Lord, I don't know what to do at this moment, and my eyes are on you. My eyes are on you. I don't know what to do, what to pray at this moment. But I pray that your holy will be done, and I pray. Praying for 15-20 minutes, and I get a call from my colleague saying that, Felix, it is done. It is done not because I prayed here, not because you went there. You know, the person was enabled by the Holy Spirit to give the required permission. And thank God we could execute that project on that day at that particular assigned time, which saved a lot of inconvenience and saved a lot of money, and we could do it successfully in the name of Jesus and in the power of the Holy Spirit. That's the power of the Holy Spirit, praying in time. The Holy Spirit prays on behalf of us, on behalf of us. So allow the Holy Spirit to intercede on behalf of you. Holy Spirit also helps us to pray. It creates a hunger in us to pray. It creates a hunger for evangelization. It creates a hunger to witness to other people. Manifest the gifts of the Holy Spirit in us. And Holy Spirit also guides us into all the truth. When we don't know what the truth is, ask the Holy Spirit and He will guide you into all the truth. All the truth. This is a short synopsis of about the life in the Holy Spirit. Let's now look at 3 important aspects in order that the Holy Spirit may work in and through me. And let's pray for this grace during this Pentecost, that I may allow the Holy Spirit to work in and through me, because the Holy Spirit is a gentle spirit. He will not force anything onto us. If we allow, He will work. If we don't allow, He will stay there. So we don't want the Holy Spirit to lie dormant in our lives. We want Him to work in and through us. I will share just three aspects, how we can allow the Holy Spirit to work in and through us. The first one is devotion. What's it? Devotion. Yes, devotion. You know, many of us are devout Christians, we say. He is a very devout Christian because he goes to church regularly, he prays regularly. And you know, there are in devotion, I divided this into three. One is devotion to God, devotion to family, and devotion to community and the society. And let's look at the first aspect, or first part in devotion, that is devotion to God. Devotion to God. And we are supposed to devote ourselves in what? Devotion in what? Prayer. Yes, you are right. We have to devote ourselves in prayer, in studying the scriptures. You are right. In intercession. Today the world needs a lot of intercession. And in sacraments, growing sacraments, the word of God, in witnessing. As we devote ourselves, the Holy Spirit enables us and works in and through us. As we are, he still works in and through us, if you only allow him. And the results of devotion leads us to become a committed Christian. Now, secondly, let's go get into the devotion towards the family. You know, many a times it is easier to devote ourselves to God, to prayer, to the work of the community, society here and there, but it's very difficult to devote ourselves to the family. I'm one of them where I keep running here and there. You know, always my wife tells me, you're not devoted yourself to the family, but you are there outside. Let's devote ourselves to the family. Very important. Very important. And when we devote ourselves to our spouse, to our children, what happens? They are able to see the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit in the family. And that's where the love abounds. They can see the gifts, the fruit of the Holy Spirit, that is patience, kindness, gentleness. And we also become, as it said in Acts 1:8, do you remember Acts 1:8? It says, then when the Holy Spirit comes, you will be empowered, and then it says you will become my witnesses. Where first? Where? Not in MIPC, but in Jerusalem, that is your home. First, witness at home. Very difficult to be a witness at home. We can be witnesses in other places. Very easy. I can go out, pray with somebody, preach to someone, help someone. Very easy to run around. I spend a whole day with the Lord and a night vigil. But devote yourself to prayer in the house is very difficult. We get irritated, angry, upset. All sort of things happen to us. You know, one of the fruit of the Holy Spirit is self-control. Of the nine fruit, self-control is the fruit. But at home, we are out of control. And many a times we are controlled by the remote control. Remote control, you know it, what I mean. That's why it's important that we devote ourselves to the family. To family prayer, scriptures, as I said earlier. Matthew 18 to 20. And where two or three gathered in my name, there am I in their midst. Family, God is present in our midst, in our midst. So it's essential that we build that bonding there, that love, that the prayer, the presence, active with the presence and power of God in our lives, in the family. And thirdly, community and others, devotion to community, others like the prayer meeting, the ministry, the cells. Yes, that has been done once a week, where we build each other, the body of Christ, helping each other, fellowship, prayer, intercession, all that has been done. So these are the three aspects of devotion. In devotion, I divide into three. One is devotion to God, devotion to family, and the third one is devotion to a community. And where we get this devotion, word devotion, in the scriptures? Go to Acts chapter 2, verse 42. Acts is a book of actions. Book of actions, and I love it so much, so much. Acts 2:42, it says, the apostles and the disciples and the believers, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of the word, of the bread, and prayers. What they did? They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of the bread, and the prayers. And verse Verse 16 says, day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous heart. With glad and generous heart. Today we, you know, eat our meals with mobiles and TV on, but they ate their meals, their food, with glad and generous heart. When you eat your meal, sit with your family. It's an anointed time. Enjoy that time, chit-chatting, talking to each other, and enjoy your meal. It's a blessing, and you will enjoy health. You will enjoy health when you do that. And this is what devotion is. And devotion is not once a month, once a year, you know, LSS or Pentecost novena. No, they devoted themselves. Verse 16 says in Acts 2:16, day by day. That means every day, every day. So we are supposed to devote ourselves to prayer, to scripture, to witnessing, to testifying, and doing works of charity. Every day, as and when we get opportunities, to our own family, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth, to our workplace, to colleagues, to meet somebody on the road, maybe a word of kindness. That is witnessing. Witnessing. We are supposed to do it in a disciplined and a devoted way every day. That is why in our community we call everyone to, you know, to respond to that 6:30 a.m. call. We are praying together day by day. Devote ourselves to that 6:30 a.m. call, and we will see the fruit of this devotion in our community. We will definitely see the fruits of this devotion to our community. And when we are committed ourselves, when we devote ourselves, what happens is the Holy Spirit gives us the gift of prudence, discernment, power, leads us all the truth, and enables us to do the task that we are supposed to do. And by this, we become a beautiful witness of Christ in whatever small or big things we do. All are not called to do great and big acts. In whatever small little thing that we do, we bring about God's presence, God's glory into manifestation in our midst. We are not supposed to compromise in our devotion to Christ, prayer. We are not supposed to compromise at all. Let's now, and then we will bear fruit here. We will bear fruit if we devote ourselves regularly to our time of prayer, to our time of scriptures, in a consistent and a disciplined way. Very, very important. Consistency and discipline. Consistency and discipline. If there is no consistency and discipline, then we will slip off. Let's now go to the second aspect, that is anointing. The first one is devotion, and the reference to it is Acts 2:42 and Acts 2:42 and verse 46 also. Acts 2:42 and Acts 2:46. And second one is anointing. Yes, anointing. Luke chapter 4. Verse 18 to 19, and there's a cross reference to it in Isaiah chapter 61, verse 1 to 2. Let's go to Luke chapter 4, verse 18 to 19. Luke chapter 4, verse 18 to 19. Says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me for a purpose, because he has anointed me to bring the good news to the poor. Poor means not financially poor as such. Those who do not know Christ, not who are living in darkness, who are, you know, groping and searching for truth, and all, we are supposed to bring them the good news. This is the purpose of anointing for each one of us. And he has sent me to proclaim release to the captives, not actually who are in prisons and all, physically, yes, to some extent, yes, but those who are, do not know the truth and then bound in captivity of wrong and darkness, by preaching the truth, the word of God and Christ. And that is what we are called to do. And here I remember, you know, we were traveling recently from Kuwait to Muscat. And in the flight, there was an emergency. As we were flying or mid-air, there was an emergency. And one of the person was very sick. Person of not a Christian, a non-Christian person was very sick, and the oxygen was brought, and the pilot announced saying that there's an emergency, if there's a doctor or the nurse, please come to help, like. And this person was administered with oxygen, and they took up the oxygen, and again they administer, saying that the condition is bad now, and as soon as we reach Muscat, we will call for an ambulance and, you know, rush it to the hospital and all. And as we were praying, as I was praying in the flight, I looked at this young girl, and I was praying, the Spirit moved me, saying that get up, go and pray with the person. Now I was finding it difficult. Then I said, nothing doing, I'll get up. I asked that person in a sign language, can I come and pray? And they said, yes, come, because there were some other friends or relatives with them, with that person. So I went and laid my hand and prayed over that person. The anointing of the Lord was upon me, and I was led to do that in the mid-air, And we realized, as we were coming to an end of the flight, and the person was almost back to normal. Not because of me, it's the power of God which enabled that person to get back to health. Glory to God. Only glory to God, and God Him, God alone. God alone. This is what happens when you're anointed. You are moved by the Spirit. Do something. Maybe it's risky at that moment, but we are not supposed to count the cost at that moment. But do it in the name of Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit. Are we not anointed? Yes, we are all anointed in the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians 3:16 says, know you not, you are the temple of the Holy Spirit. As I said earlier, we are all temple of the Holy Spirit. The Spirit of God dwells within each one of us. And it is our sins and our failings and our, you know, attachment to the worldly things which keeps us away from this power in that anointing that we have. We are not able to operate in that anointing because of our sinfulness, because of our failures. So we are called to repent and return to the Lord, like Psalmist David prayed in Psalm 51. Restore unto me to the joy of thy salvation. Get back to repent and get back to God's grace immediately, from the state of sin to the state of grace. We can see some scriptural personalities, how they operated in the anointing of the Holy Spirit. The one important example is about Mother Mary. Mother Mary, when she heard the message about conceiving Jesus in her womb, she was confused and disturbed. But with all humility, she said, yes to the will of the Father. She's not like Paul and Stephen and other powerful apostles and disciples. But she was a humble witness of Jesus Christ. Very humble. Not all are called to be like Paul and like Peter, wherein through their sermon 3,000 people will come to know Jesus. No, all are not called to do that. There are some, yes. Everyone is given different gifts and charisms. We have to operate in that. Ask the Lord, what is my gift, and operate in that gift. We cannot imitate someone else. We will fail. And we have to operate in the gift that God has given to me, and you will be fruitful in that gift. Mother Mary, we know what happened to her. And then we know the very example of Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit at River Jordan. And also after 40 days of fast and prayer, before you could start his ministry, God empowered and anointed him. And he went out preaching, teaching, healing, and also resurrecting people from their death. We have an example of Lazarus. 4 days later, after his death, he was raised to life. We also know about the apostles. We know what happened to them after the death of Jesus. They all went back to their old life, knowing that it's end, finished. There is nothing more now. But then, after the resurrection of Jesus, They were all came back to life, and Mother Mary, along with them, they all waited on the Lord in fasting, in prayer for 10 days. 10 days they were in the upper room in a lockdown condition. So lockdown condition should not disable us, but should enable us to explore ways and means to proclaim God's glory. And we know what happened to them. They were empowered by the Holy Spirit and went about preaching, teaching, and turning the world upside down. This is what happens with anointing. So the first aspect I shared is about devotion. I said devotion to God, devotion to family, devotion to community. The important aspect is devotion to God first, then family. And the third one is to the community. And the second one is anointing. And the third one now is empowerment and witnessing through this anointing. Once you are anointed and begin to operate in the anointing, you are empowered. You are empowered. For example, we read in Acts 4:13 and Acts 4:29. You know what happens to Peter and John there? The rulers, elders and scribes, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and realized that they were uneducated and ordinary men, they were amazed and recognized them as companions of Jesus. You see, they recognized them as companions of Jesus. And that is what happens when you are empowered and able to witness. They did not witness there, but the scribes, Pharisees, elders and rulers recognized them as companions of Jesus. Auto witnessing there. The result of empowerment. And empowerment happened because of anointing, and anointing happened because of devotion. So if there is no devotion, it is very difficult to have that anointing. And if there is no anointing, it will not be empowered, and there will not be much witnessing. And even if we are doing witnessing, it will not have much effect. And then I remember here sometime back last year when I went to Lulu to buy something, and there was an offer, buy three and get one free, like. And I bought certain amount to give gifts to people, and I was going on leave, and came to the cash counter, and it was supposed to be 48 riyals, and the cashier said no, it is only 28 riyals. I said no, it's 48 riyals. She said no. Then I said no, it is 48. And then I called the customer service manager. I said, please help her to calculate properly. It is 48 riyals and I want to pay 48 riyals for this according to my calculation. But can you work out? And he worked out and he said, yes, you are right. Thank you so much, he said. What did he do? He recognized Jesus in me. He did not see me, but he saw Jesus in me. And I could see a smile on his face. He said, you know, honest fellow. So are we good according to the scriptures? As I said, Stephen is known as a good person because he was full of the Holy Spirit and of faith. So when we do these small little acts, this was an insignificant act, very insignificant act, you know, but then when you do these small little acts, people will recognize Jesus in and through you, And also we read in Acts 4:29, you know, empowering and witnessing, also we got to pay a price for this. We got to pay a price. It's not going to be easy, because the apostles and the disciples and believers went through difficult time. Very difficult time. There is so much of persecution and suffering they went through. Before they were empowered and witness. And even after witnessing, you know, they had to go to the prison and go through suffering, and many of them were killed because of their faith, which we read, which we know very well in the history of the church. And Peter and John was released from the prison according to Acts 4:29, when they released from the prison, they came to their friends who are believers, came to the friends who are believers and wanted to share their experience, and they shared, and they, their friends and believers, prayed to the Lord, and they prayed in such a way, and they said, they prayed in such a way, they said, Lord, look at the threats and grant to your servants to speak your word with all boldness. When they prayed, the whole place shook. And if I had to go through that same experience, released from the prison, I would have called somebody before that, can you get me out of the prison first? And when I come home, I'll say, allow me to relax for some time. And I've gone through a terrible time. And here, can you imagine, the friends and Peter and John are praying for further boldness to proclaim the word with all the more boldness and power and grace. Power and grace. Yeah, I remember another story here. You know, a friend of mine, I went to police station and he had some work there, and the reception, the cop wouldn't allow him because he wanted to meet the superintendent of police in that police station because of the work. And he said, no, you can't go without appointment. He said, do you know who I am? He said, I am the son of my heavenly father and brother of Jesus Christ. And the cop was stunned there, and this fellow walked and went and met the officer, finished his job, came back, and he said, you know, this is the power of witnessing. Because he was empowered, he could witness there, and nobody could stop him. Nobody could stop him from doing and proclaiming and witnessing Christ there. Witnessing Christ there. Let's now, you know, look at these aspects that I shared. Let us close our eyes for a moment. As the Pentecost is approaching fast, let it not become an yearly event for us. Let it become a new experience. Let there be a new Pentecost. Let there be a new grace. Let there be a new anointing, that I may become a new creation in Christ. Let's ask the Lord, what is His purpose for this anointing, this empowerment for me? Am I called to live the life that I'm living now, or am I need to change the way I'm living? Considering the present situation and the future, am I going to live the way God wants me to live in order to become an effective witness? Am I going to devote myself to prayer, to scripture, to Eucharist, to reconciliation, to witnessing, to fellowship? Am I going to allow myself to be anointed daily with a consistent and a disciplined way? Am I going to be empowered and become a witness? Or is it an event that I will go through? No, dear brothers and sisters, that is not God's purpose for me. He wants me to live and glorify Him through my life. Let us ask the Lord to give us the grace. Let us ask the Lord to help us to sincerely devote ourselves for the next 10 days and thereafter consistently and continuously, day by day, to pray, to read the word, to meditate and allow the Holy Spirit to work in and through me, to be anointed, to be empowered, and to be a witness. Lord, help each one of us, O God. Help me, O Master. Help my family, O God. Help everyone who is listening to your word today, O Master, that you help us to come back to you, Lord God, O Master. We repent of our sins, O Lord God. We come back to you. Forgive our sins, and we want to, oh Lord, get back to that first love, O God, where you saved us and delivered us, O Lord God, O Master, where we are full of zeal and enthusiasm and anointing and power, O God. Help us to get back to that. Empower us, O Lord God, O Master, so that we may devote ourselves to you, Lord God. We may be anointed, O Lord God, O Master, daily, and that we may be empowered and become your witnesses to the ends of the earth, as it said in Matthew 28, verse 18 to 20, O God. Help us, guide us, and lead us in the power of the Holy Spirit, O Lord Jesus Christ. O Father, in your forgiving and healing love, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Glory to God in the highest. Announcements. Dear brothers and sisters, we thank God for everyone who made it possible for us to have this online meetings, praise and worship and sharing the word. We thank every brother, every sister who devoted themselves, who spent time, who sacrificed. We pray God's abundant blessings on you, and through this we may be able to experience God's grace to us and able to minister to others as well. We thank God for the technology, and as we are going to start the Pentecost Novena from tomorrow, from 22nd of May till 30th of May, from Friday 22nd of May till Saturday 30th of May, all 9 days from 8 to 9. Yeah, log on to MIPC website, and it is from 8 to 9. And also we'll be having our online intercessory meeting on 1st of June at 8 p.m. 8 p.m. All these timings are Oman or UAE time. Oman or UAE time. So you can, those who are not in Oman, you can look at the timing, and please join us. Please join us. And the scripture reading for the week from 22nd to 28th May is Gospel of John chapter 16. Gospel of John chapter 16. Verse for the week to memorize is John chapter 14 verse 26. John chapter 14 verse 26. Let us all proclaim and profess it together. But the advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Intention for the week, starting from May 22nd to May 28th, gift and fruit of the Holy Spirit. Gifts and fruit of the Holy Spirit. Let us all pray together. Come, Holy Spirit, and baptize me with the fire of your love. I yield now to receive sanctification gifts of Isaiah 11, verse 2, wisdom and understanding, counsel and might, knowledge and the fear of the Lord. I yield and ask you to release your manifestation gifts of service as listed in 1 Corinthians 12, wisdom, knowledge, faith, healing, miracles, prophecy, discernment, tongues, and interpretation of tongues. Only by your power, guided by your Spirit, can my life be fruitful. Holy Spirit, come. I want it all, wrapped in the greatest gift of all, love. Melt and mold me, fill and use me. Jesus, you are the true vine, and prune me so that I bear much fruit. Help me to abide in you always. Live your word and let the Holy Spirit work in and through me to be God's witness everywhere. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Let's take a deep breath for the victory call. Jesus is Lord, now and forever. Now and forever, Jesus is Lord. And all God's devoted, anointed, empowered, and witnessing people say, Amen. Amen. Good night and God bless.